So, after the coalition deal was signed on Friday, all that is left now is for the new government to be sworn in. For the new finance minister, though, it means a very, very, very busy few weeks ahead. Nicola Willis is with us this morning. Kia ora, good morning.
Kia ora, good morning.
You have just had your first briefing from Treasury. What did they say?
Look, they said there's some real pressure on New Zealand's finances and some challenges ahead for our economy. It's fair to say that the outgoing government has left us with some nasty surprises. There are some fiscal risks that are pretty significant that we're going to have to work hard to manage. Fiscal risks being things that could cost the government a lot of money if we don't manage them well. There's also some fiscal cliffs, that is, programs that are currently ongoing that the government hasn't budgeted to keep funding in the future. So we'll need to assess each of those too.
Where are those surprises specifically?
Well, what I've had for the first time is an opportunity to be briefed on some of the areas of spending that have become blowouts and to understand just the beginning of that. So my task over the coming week or two is to dig into that into deeper detail, and I'll work to be as transparent as I can with New Zealanders about what those risks are and what the opportunities are for us to tighten things up.
So how much is this going to affect your bottom line? If you look at expenditure projections, revenue projections at the moment, are we talking hundreds of millions of dollars? Are we talking billions of dollars here?
Well, we've got a great opportunity to share that information with New Zealand at the half-year economic and fiscal update. We're going to turn that into a mini-budget.
Great opportunity right now as well, Nicola.
Well, we're going to turn that into a mini-budget, and that will be before Christmas. And
right.
At that time, we will open up the books, we'll share with New Zealanders what we're seeing, what the projections are for the economy over the next few years, and our response to those conditions, what our priorities will be as a government.
So what else are you going to be putting in that mini budget? Because you only have a very small window to get that sorted.
Well, we'll work very hard over the next couple of weeks to see if there are some savings and reprioritisations we can get into that initial mini budget. I'm conscious that time is very limited. We want to make sure we're taking proper advice, that we're being prudent, that we're being careful. So it'll be necessarily limited. Emphasis on the word mini.
When you think of those surprises, is there any specific area that really took you back, that stands out as something that you weren't necessarily expecting on the information you had prior to your briefing?
Yes, and I will have more to say about that in the coming days.
Okay. Let's talk about some of the details in those coalition agreements. So one thing that stuck out to me is that you are now set to be introducing interest deductibility for residential landlords faster than you had previously planned. How's that going to impact your revenue in the next year or two?
So National had campaigned on interest deductibility staying at 50% from April next year. We've agreed in the coalition agreement with ACT to lift that to 60%, and then the year after that we'd campaigned on a 75% deductibility. We've agreed with ACT to make that 80%. Deductibility. So that will have some impact in terms of revenue. Again, I'm yet to take detailed advice on exactly what those costings are, but we think they're manageable within our broader fiscal plan, which has significant buffers in it.
Okay, so the foreign buyer's tax is gone on your numbers, which we don't need to re-examine. That means you miss out on more than $700 million a year. So to pay for the revenue shortage, you are going to scrap changes to Working for Families. You're going to review an app tax, which you specifically campaigned against. You're going to scrap the smoke-free New Zealand changes, which will improve your excise revenue. Will you still need to borrow in order to fund those cuts?
No, because what we did in our fiscal plan, and it's really important to remember this, is that we left significant buffers over the forecast period. That is, we put together a plan based on operating allowances of extra spending, but we didn't actually allocate all of that spending. We left buffers of unspent money. So in approaching our tax plan, all of the three parties in the coalition know that we need to reduce the cost of living, know that New Zealanders need to keep more of what they earn. We want to deliver them tax reduction, but do that in a way that maintains New Zealand's fiscal and economic strength.
Scrapping the smoke-free changes will bring in more taxes because more people will be smoking. Do you accept it will also mean more people will die?
Well, I just want to take you back a step because the logic for the smoke-free changes is not about tax revenue. The logic from both ACT and New Zealand First when they came to the negotiating table was their concern that changes planned for the future to those laws would have a couple of nasty side effects. One, they were concerned about the emergence of a big black market for tobacco, unregulated, untaxed. Mm. Second, they were concerned that by vastly reducing the number of retail outlets to around 600, that we could see a huge increase in retail crime, ram raids, people being put in danger. So their concerns were around the regulation. Mm. I'd invite you, I think you've got David on the show later, to talk more about where they're coming from on that. And what we've agreed in the coalition agreements is not to proceed with the further changes that the government was planning.
That doesn't go to my question, though. Do you accept that scrapping those changes will mean more people will die?
Well, I have not seen advice or analysis of that, so I'm not prepared to give you an answer.
They studied the potential changes before they were introduced, did modelling around the numbers. At the moment, 5,000 people a year die from smoking-related disease in New Zealand. And the numbers released before these changes were introduced suggested that they would save about 8,000 lives by the year 2040.
Well, there is an ongoing commitment from this government to reduce the number of people smoking, to stop people smoking in the first place, to reduce the harm from smoking, to support people to quit. Mm. And you will see that in the way that Dr. Shane Retty goes about his health leadership. Look, one of the things that has dropped smoking rates significantly in recent years is that people have chosen to take up vaping instead, which obviously I don't want my 13-year-old taking up vaping, so be very clear about that. But equally, for people who were using a much more harmful product, that has helped them with stopping smoking.
Do you have any
smoking.
Moral reservations about these changes?
Well, I would be really worried if we were going backwards from where the law currently is. And as you know, the law currently restricts access for minors. It makes smokes very expensive so that they are hard to obtain. There are significant health warnings in shops. Access to those products is pretty restricted.
But these next steps were world-leading.
Well, they haven't been done before, and therefore there is no proof or evidence that they would have had the effects that were promised.
OK, so no moral reservations.
Well, as I've said to you, morally, I want fewer people smoking.
Okay.
And I think that we need to keep that goal in mind.
You called the most recent iteration of the PGF a big money hose of taxpayer cash sloshing all around. Mm. You've agreed to a $1.2 billion regional infrastructure fund. So explain to us how that's going to be different.
Well, first thing is we're looking at capital funding. So what that means is funding for long-term infrastructure assets that are designed to be there for decades into the future and that create an asset on the Crown's balance sheet. So these are long-held things. The second thing is, I think we can learn lessons from the PGF to ensure that we've got really good accountability mechanisms, that before we agree to fund projects, we know they can be delivered, and to ensure that they are delivering the results that were promised.
What were your concerns with accountability under the PGF?
Well, the Auditor General had a look at the PGF and was clear that because it was often set up in quite a hurry, that there weren't necessarily those processes in place to ensure that projects were funded were delivering the things that were promised. Mm.
So will it be just Shane Jones that has oversight when it comes to ministerial oversight of this fund, or will you have input there as well?
Well, the Minister of Infrastructure is Chris Bishop. I'd expect him to be working alongside Shane Jones, and I'd expect to be part of that as well.
Will capital projects that benefit the racing industry be eligible?
Well, obviously, Cabinet has not even discussed or considered criteria, but what I'd be expecting is regional projects, roads and the like.
OK. So for example, a synthetic racetrack in Christchurch, I think, won $10.5 million under the initial iteration of the PGF. Would something like that, in your expectation, as per the deal, be eligible for this funding?
Well, for that to meet the test for Crown capital funding, it would have to be an asset that the Crown would have an ownership stake in for some time. So that would seem unlikely at first glance, but as I say, we haven't even set up criteria yet, Jack.
Under New Zealand First's coalition deal, there is a commitment to increase funding for IRD tax audits, to urgently expand IRD tax audit capacity. How much?
We haven't decided that yet. We'll be taking advice on it. I really liked this suggestion from New Zealand First, which is that they have looked around the world and seen that where countries have put more money into their auditing capability, they've actually been able to uncover a lot of revenue. This is about making sure that people pay the tax they owe. It's about fairness. And if we can beef up our auditing function in New Zealand to ensure that happens, that's a great thing.
Is it going to be targeted at any one group in particular?
We haven't had a discussion about that yet. My goal would be to target it at where we think there is the most revenue being lost right now, because every dollar that people are avoiding in tax that they should be paying is a dollar that doesn't go towards our schools, our hospitals, tax relief for Kiwis.
So what group is that right now? Where do you think that is right now?
I don't have a view on that, Jack, but we will be taking advice on that. I'm sure that the Inland Revenue Department have some ideas about if only we had a few more resources and a few more auditors, this is where we'd target them. So we'll be asking them for that advice.
Will it be informed at all by David Parker's study into high net wealth individuals?
I'm not sure that there is any correlation between those two things.
Talk to us about your role as Associate Climate Minister.
Well, I'm really delighted to have that role. I view climate change as the most significant environmental challenge of our age, but also a significant economic challenge. It requires us to reform our economy, to get carbon out of it, and to prepare for a growing number of weather-related risks. So there are massive financial and economic implications of how New Zealand responds to climate change. At the same time, in Simon Watts, our climate change minister, we have someone extremely astute, wise, very focused on those challenges. He'll do a great job. But by me being there as associate, I can ensure that climate change is at the cabinet table, at the top of the cabinet table, and being thought about across the decisions
we are making. So why not have the climate change minister in cabinet?
Well, there's only 20 seats at the cabinet table, only 14 of them are being filled by national ministers.
Sure, but if it's as important and critical as you say it is, as an issue?
Well, it is a critical issue, it is an important issue, and as James Shaw demonstrated, it's a portfolio that can be led effectively outside cabinet.
James Shaw is from the Green Party, of course.
Yes, he is, and Simon Watts is from the National Party. He'll approach climate change differently, I'm sure, and he'll do a great job.
So you think James Shaw was effective as climate change minister?
I think he knew his stuff.
Looking into the long term, it's interesting, there is no rise in the retirement age, and I know that it's a very long term thing, but it does mean in the future the New Zealand government will have to spend significantly more on superannuation. To what degree do issues like that influence the decisions you are likely to make in the coming weeks?
Well, I think one of the best pieces of advice I've had in recent days is when you become a new minister, you have a rush of urgent decisions coming at you. But always take the time to think about the long term. And I want to be a finance minister that does that. Alongside this portfolio, I have the social investment portfolio. And ultimately what that's about is saying, what are the things that the government could invest in differently, earlier in people's lives or in different ways that would prevent their lives going off the rails in the longer run or prevent them fulfilling their potential? How can we be more clever about the dollars we put in to get a longer term return? A longer return in terms of human potential, but also actually reducing the cost to the state. Because when people do badly, when families do badly, when communities do badly, that comes at a cost to us all.
How is that going to differ from Louise Upston's work?
Well, Louise Upston is the Social Development Minister, so she will be overseeing New Zealand's social security framework, our welfare system, the support we give people when they're not in work. Part of her work will be taking a social investment approach to see what interventions will help those groups of New Zealanders. But social investment is broader than just that portfolio. It's also about what we do in education. It's about what we do in the health system. It's about what we do in the law and order area. So all of our ministers will be tasked with taking a social investment mindset.
Have you heard from the Productivity Commission since Friday?
I haven't.
Would you expect to?
I wouldn't expect to. I do want to just show some compassion, which is it must be hard to read in a coalition agreement that the organisation you're part of is being disestablished. Obviously, that's part of the ACT agreement that will free up some resources and allow them to set up the Ministry for Regulation, which will support David Seymour and his red tape cutting work.
But it wasn't anything that was actually campaigned on, was it?
No, I don't think it was, but we, I think, have a very strong mandate from New Zealanders to look across public services to identify those that aren't adding maximum value and to ensure those resources are redeployed.
I know you've been asked this already. I know you were asked this in the lead up to the campaign. I'm hoping you're going to give us a bit more specificity than you have in the past. What are we looking like in terms of job losses across the public sector at the moment? Because you identified cuts of over 6% in the run-up to the election, but there was no specificity in that deal with ACT.
Well, what we now need to do is create a program of savings reduction. We inherit unfinished work from the outgoing government, who said they'd do baseline reviews but haven't actually identified where all of those savings will come from. We then have our program of reducing some of the back office bureaucracy and reducing consultancy and contracting spend. We'll bring that together. We'll set targets for individual agencies. And what our agreement with ACCS is when we're setting those targets, we'll be informed by looking at the data to say, well, there's the agency that's really grown its headcount, so where you would expect that there would be more reductions. But I still don't have a headcount target. That's not what I'm targeting. What I'm targeting is long-term sustainable savings so that we can have a much tidier set of government books.
Good luck for the next few weeks.
Thank you
for your time. The soon-to-be Finance Minister, I think that's what we have to call you, Finance Minister-elect until tomorrow at the very least, Nicola Willis.